Hello, hello, welcome to JS 356, the Java API for Java WebSocket. I am Jitendra, I work at Oracle. I am working in the WebSocket, this particular JSR's reference implementation. So this is a standard safe harbor statement from Oracle. Okay. So briefly, we'll talk about WebSocket. I am sure like some of you are familiar with WebSocket, but those of you who are not familiar, we'll just go over about the WebSocket protocol. Then the bulk of the talk we spend in JSR 356 API, and we'll have a small demo if we have some time. Okay. So I think around early 2000s, I think the sites started become more and more interactive. So they started adding content or services that require two-way communication. So, but HTTP being a request response, it became kind of difficult to achieve the two-way communication. They kind of have to simulate two-way communication on top of HTTP's request response protocol. So this, some of the techniques have emerged, and they are primarily to overcome some of the limitations of HTTP. So they try to simulate this two-way communication using, say periodic polling or some variations of polling. Or they keep the connection open, and whenever the client wants to send the some data to the server, they start opening one more connection. So think about from the server side, like to receive the content, it has to open a connection for every request, and to send data to the client, it has one more connection. So it is dealing with multiple TCP connections. So this is kind of inefficient. Also, HTTP adds lot of overhead for each message. For each message has HTTP headers. To just send few bytes of data, so you have to send the whole HTTP headers, which are few kilobytes. So that adds quite a bit of overhead in the protocol, as well as it also adds lot of latency. So this is not really suitable for like any applications that want real-time communication or they want more responsive. So HTTP was not really suitable for that kind of two-way communication. So when HTML5 started, it started looking at this particular problem. So it came up with two technologies. One is server-sent events, other is WebSocket. So server-sent events primarily started with just a JavaScript API for the browser, and it defines a little bit protocol for on top of HTTP itself. So the basic idea behind the server sent events is whenever server has some data, it can push the notifications via server sent events. So it's suitable for some of the applications, like for example, streaming stock code, stock code kind of applications where only the server has to keep pushing the data, but still it's not two-way communication. So other protocol which was in the works was WebSocket protocol, where it provides basically a TCP-oriented connection. And once the connection is established, it provides bidirectional full duplex messaging. So originally, it started part of HTML5 working group. Then it became two separate working groups. One is like the protocol is being standardized by the IETF, which is already a standard in RFC 6455. And on the other hand, the client side, the API for the browser, so that is being done in W3C working group. So that's not it final, it's in candidate recommendation stage. So let's see, what is the basic idea? So the basic idea here is to establish a TCP connection so that both client and server can start sending messages independent of each other. And they can whenever client wants to send a message to the server, it can send. Or whenever the server wants to send a message, it can send. So it's just like something like you can think about TCP connection with a little bit of messaging on top of it. And whenever any peer, I call basically client and server as a peer because they're pretty much equivalent once the connection is established. So whenever any of the peers in the conversation want to close the connection, they can always close the connection. So that's the basic idea of WebSocket protocol. Okay, so let's see in a small diagram like client and how server establish a connection. So client sends a handshake request, and server takes its time to validate the request and sends handshake response. and client validates a response. Once that is happened, then basically the connection will be established. Let's take a look at the handshake request. So the handshake request is primarily just a HTTP request. So the only thing is it uses the standard upgrade mechanism. HTTP 1.1 itself has this standard upgrade mechanism so that it can support to any newer version of, if a request can upgrade to newer version of HTTP protocol or completely different protocol. So it already has an upgrade mechanism in HTTP 1.1. So it uses the same mechanism to upgrade to the WebSocket. I think outside of WebSocket, I think some cases of TLS, they used to use this upgrade mechanism. So as you could see in this HTTP request, sends some headers, which are like, for example, upgrade. It's saying that I want to upgrade to the WebSocket connection. And it also sends a small dongle. I'll come back to on this, what is the key it is sending and how that is related when the response comes back. So it also sends a origin header so that the server can decide what all the requests from which origin it wants to respond. If it doesn't like requests coming from some other origin, it can basically decline those requests. And in the HTTP handshake request, you can also basically negotiate a sub-protocol. So these are like application level protocols. So for example, your application, if it wants to deal with, let's say I know how to interpret the messages as a chat protocol. So you can negotiate between client and server, who knows how to deal with chat. So they can negotiate certain kind of application level protocols. So there is a provision to negotiate sub protocols. And the last one is version which corresponds to at present RFC standard version. So once this request is received by the server, so server responds with a handshake response. It says that, okay, I understand this history, the WebSocket protocol. So it responds saying that I'm switching the protocols. So it sends 101 HTTP status code. And it says that I'm upgrading to WebSocket. So then it responds with a accept header. So that is basically a small algorithm is there, which takes whatever the client sent a key, and it uses some algorithm and computes this particular data. So that gives a guarantee to the client that the server really understands the WebSocket. It's not like any other fake server which is basically sending this particular response. So it knows that it gives only basic guarantee, saying that the server really understands the WebSocket protocol. It's not talking with some other random server. And in this case, both client and server have negotiated a sub-protocol called chat. So once the response is validated by the client, then the connection is kind of established. So once the connection is established between client and server, it's pretty much symmetrical. So there is no concept of basically client and server. As far as they are concerned, they are peers in certain conversation. So the client can send some messages, and server can send some messages independent of client. So I'll just briefly go over about what a message. The basic form of unit on the wire protocol is basically a frame. A frame could be a test frame or a binary frame. And a message could consist of multiple text frames or multiple binary frames. So a text message could be a text frame, basically a list of text frames, or a binary message could be a list of binary frames. So in between these binary, in the frames of a message, you can also interleave with some control frames. For example, let's say client wants to send a ping message, and it wants to know the health of the server. So it just wants to know whether the server is really alive. So it can send a ping message and expect a pong message. Similarly, server also can send a ping frame and can expect a pong frame. Also, client can just itself can send unsolicited pong frames just to say that, okay, I am alive, and it can send a pong frame to the other peer. So these frames can interleave between any message. But at a higher level, you can think of that between client and server, they are exchanging either a text message or a binary message. That's all you need to know. And any party, any of the peers, can close the connection whenever they want. Okay, so here, let's say client has sent a close frame, and the connection is basically disconnected. So let's see basically some WebSocket wire messages on the protocol. So this traffic is captured using a Wireshark. So here the client is sending, okay, I want slash hello WebSocket. So it sent a HTTP request. So the server responded with, So the server responded with HTTP 1.1200, okay. Then that page contains a resource basically that opens a connection to the server. So here it sent a handshake request, gets slash hello WebSocket slash echo. And it also sent a icon page. Basically it sent a request for icon. So what server did is, so I don't know whether you can see the mouse, okay. The server responded with 101 switching the protocols. So it understands the handshake request, it responded with a handshake response. And where is my cursor? And for icon, there is no icon in this particular web server. So it responded with 404. So from that point onwards, they are communicating using the messages. So here client sent a frame, which is a WebSocket text. And here there are not many, there is only one frame that itself is the final frame. That's what the fin says. And whenever the client sends to server, it masks the data also due to for some security reasons. And the servers responded with one more text message, and that is a final frame. So it's that message contains only one frame. Similarly, one more message has been sent from between the client and server. So WebSocket also provides a way to extend the functionality of the protocol itself. So that's what called as WebSocket extensions. So there are a bunch of extensions that are in works. I don't think any of the extensions are final yet. So one is a multiplexing extension, which allows taking a physical connection, you can have multiple WebSocket channels on top of a single physical connection. So that is in the works. And also compression for each frame or a message, there is one extension is, some extensions are in works, but they are not final yet. So as I said that between client and server, both parties can negotiate a certain protocol which are specific to your application, for example, chat or anything. There are four, I think, officially registered sub-protocols. I think some of them are in the final and some of them are not at final. So they are still in the works. So for example, message broker, I think it brings some kind of JMS kind of functionality between the client and server. Okay. So let's summarize what does WebSocket protocol has. It primarily starts with a HTTP handshake. It works on any other, it takes advantage of HTTP infrastructure which is already out there, like HTTP proxies or routers, etc. So you don't really require any special configuration, typically. And once the handshake is established, both peers can exchange data, either in the text message or in the binary message. And there are also control frames which will tell the health of a client or a server. And they don't have any HTTP overhead. For example, if you want to send just say a message hello, which has 5 bytes, all you require is typically 2 bytes. If you include masking, it probably requires 6 more bytes, that's it. But the same message, if you want to send using HTTP, perhaps you have to send HTTP headers itself is around 1 kilobytes of HTTP headers you have to send. So the overhead when you are sending using WebSocket protocol, it's very minimal, just 2 to 6 bytes. And there is a close frame to close the connection. Any party can close the connection. It's fully duplex and bidirectional. So that means you can take advantage of the protocol and write applications that are collaborative in nature, like chat applications, some group kind of collaboration to editing a document, for example. So certain kind of applications are very much possible using the WebSocket protocol. So let's take a look at what is available on the client side. The client side, there is a WebSocket API, which is not at final. It's but most of the browsers already support this JavaScript API. So it provides a bunch of event handlers to handle, let's say, if the connection is established via OnOpen connect handler, OnOpen event handler, or you can register an event handler whenever there is a message, how to handle that particular message. Similarly for close, and if there is any error happens, you can register your own event handlers. You can send text messages, or you can send binary messages from JavaScript, or it also has a mechanism to support the subprotocols. While creating the WebSocket, you can say that, okay, my client, my JavaScript client understands this particular subprotocol. Let's take a look at the browser support. I think you can Google yourself, but the main important thing is the last one, which is highlighted in the current. So most of the browsers, like for example, Firefox, Chrome, Safari, they all support it. I think, and even on the, for example, on tablets, most of the browsers pretty much support it, like iOS client that supports WebSocket. I think the only current browser which doesn't support is IE 9.0, but they have plans to support in 10.0. So either the support is already there in most of the browsers, or it is coming up. So you can Google yourself. I think there is one website which publishes this information often. So let's take a look at some of the Java WebSocket implementations. Most of the servlet containers you know of, like Tomcat, for example, Jetty, or JBoss, they all support WebSocket. From our perspective, we've been supporting WebSocket via Grizzly, a Grizzly project. And we recently, sometime back, we also started playing, supporting, creating a WebSocket applications using little bit higher level abstractions, using annotations, for example. So that we did in WebSocket SDK, that sort of led to this particular JSR. So then this JSR 356 happened, which will provide a standard API for creating WebSocket applications in the Java platform. So it's very much running, and we have a EDR draft is already available, and we are expecting a public review to happen in December time frame, and it's going to be part of Java E7, which is coming up in April 2013. So all the expert group communication is kind of transparent, and we are doing this in an open source project, WebSocket spec.java.net project, and you can really follow even the expert group communication, as well as there is a user's mailing list. You can really ask for any features or discuss, and most of the expert group members also follow the whatever is happening on the user's mailing list. So all the communication is happening publicly. And there is a public Jira issue, and also there is a readable archive for all the mailing lists. So similarly, the reference implementation is being done in an open source project under Glassfish community project. So it's called Tyrus, tyrus.java.net. And its basic origins, as I said, it's originated from WebSocket SDK project. And it works in standalone mode, and it is also working in Java EE kind of deployment. The latest bits we periodically integrate into Glassfish 4 builds, which is Java EE 7 reference implementation. So let's take a look at JSR 356 expert groups. Some of the experts actually they are already part of the Solvet expert group. They have been represented here. As you could see, most of the corporate members are there. Many individual projects like Jetty and many other popular projects, they are all representing in this particular expert group and providing the feedback. Okay, so before I go into the API, I just want to let you know that the project is in very much flux. So even actually after I put up these slides, there are quite a few things have changed. So to note that these APIs might change before the final release. So, but the direction probably you will see, like the programming model, what we are trying to attempt while creating the Java applications, that probably will remain the same. But just remember that the APIs will not be exactly the same. Okay. So the API contains two programming models. One is like annotation driven, which could be used, and that one very well integrated with Java E kind of web containers with other features. I have a slide which is coming up. And then we have a interface driven, so which if you want, you can use in standalone. Also, you can use in EE kind of environment, where you will be extending certain interface and creating a WebSocket endpoint out of it. So basically, there are two programming models. So let's take a look at first the annotation-driven programming model. So we see in Java EE, like you can take a POJO and you can decorate with some annotation, and that turns into some interesting particular EE component. For example, you take a POJO and annotate with, let's say, stateless, it becomes a stateless EJB. Similarly, if there is a POJO and if you annotate with the web service annotation, it becomes a SOAP-based web service endpoint. Similarly, here I have a POJO, which is a Hello Bean POJO, and it is annotated with the WebSocket endpoint annotation, and it is saying that this particular endpoint will be hosted at slash hello path, and that turns the Hello Bean as an endpoint and reasoning for the WebSocket request at slash hello. And to, let's say, if you want to receive any messages, you can annotate certain methods using WebSocket message, and those messages are like basically event handlers for on message. Like whenever there is a message, the runtime tries to map that particular message to the method, it will invoke those method if there is a particular match. So in this case, all it is doing is there is a hello method which is taking a string parameter. So if there is a message and if it is a text message, it will convert that text message to string and invokes this particular method. And the package which we started was javax.net.websocket.annotations or javax.net.websocket actually. But in the last week or so, I think it's the net and annotations are dropped. Pretty much all the classes, they will be part of javax.websocket. That's a package it's going to be. Okay. So now you know how to receive the message. So if you want to send messages, in this case, there is, even though you can send messages anytime you want, but this particular method, hello, it's basically asynchronous. So it receives a message and it immediately wants to send some message, for example. So it's basically a convenience kind of method. So it is returning a string instead of void. So the moment it receives a message, it's echoing that particular string back. So let's say if it is receiving hello world and it just echoing the string back in this particular example. So that's possible. And most of the time, that probably is not interesting, right? Probably you will be just dealing with just the strings or whatever the supported objects in the platform. But you, at the application, you want to deal with application level objects, like I want to deal with my drawing object or my chat message or any other message. So for that, so one could say that like this method primarily takes a client hello message and it returns, let's say, a server hello message. But then how does the server runtime knows how to map, if there is a message comes, how to map to these custom objects? So for that, in the WebSocket endpoint, you could specify what all the encoders and decoders you have. So those will be used to convert, basically serialize and deserialize the objects to the corresponding bytes. So in this case, the server hello encoder will be used to convert the bytes to, basically convert server hello to encode it to the bytes. Similarly, the decoder will be used to the client hello to receive the bytes and convert into client hello. So I have a demo for this particular example. So the other thing is, so you also want to receive the lifecycle events, like whenever there is a connection is established, how do you want to know? So, or whenever the connection is terminated, how exactly you want to know? For that, the spec created three or four annotations. One is a WebSocket open, which will be invoked when the client is when a client connects to this particular peer. Similarly, when the connection is disconnected or the client sends a close frame, at that time WebSocket close method will be called. Or if there is any communication error happens, all the errors could be directed to this particular method. So whenever these events happen, the corresponding methods will be invoked. So as you could see that the session parameter here, they take a session parameter. So the session parameter you can think about like it's a little broadly named as such. Probably it may be changed the name. So it's something like represents a connection, a conversation. So from that session, you could always get the remote endpoint and you can start sending the messages and you can do a lot of other things. So then what happens, what is the life cycle of this particular bean itself? So initially it started as like something like a servlet kind of life cycle. So all the requests come to one particular instance. As you know, in the servlet case, the servlet container creates one instance. All the requests basically come to the same instance. So that's how I think the WebSocket also started. So it creates one instance of chat bean. All the client requests basically coming to the same instance. But in the recent time, it's kind of changed that the bean's instance will be created per connection. So whenever there is a client connection, so there is an instance. If there is a new connection, then there will be a new instance. So that's the change which happened in the last few weeks. So that gives like if you want to keep certain data per connection, you can keep it in the instance itself rather than keeping that state outside the bin. So that's one advantage. And moreover, this is a kind of long-running connection that kind of makes sense to keep a connection-oriented instance for each connection. Okay, so that's the life cycle event. As I said, some of these things are keep on changing, and actually a lot of implementations are trying to implement simultaneously along with the reference implementation. For example, I know that Jetty is making a progress, Tomcat is making a progress simultaneously. Of course, reference implementation is definitely making progress on some of these proposals. It also supports URI templates. As you might know that JAX-RS already supports templates and it's quite popular. So for example, in this case, the my endpoint takes listens to any request that has slash order slash which is dynamic. The order ID is a template. So for example, if you say order slash one, so that particular request will be matched here with the order ID, and that order ID you can get it in any of the methods. Like for example, you could get it via WebSocket path param here with the order ID. So for this request, the order ID, the string order ID will be one. But if you have invoked some other request with orders two or something, so you will get the string as that particular value. There is also a Jira issue to convert, for example, not just string, or to convert to any particular, like for example, in this case it's integer, so the order ID could be integer. So the runtime will automatically convert this parameter to integer. So there is a Jira issue. At present, the support is only for the string parameters. So this allows, for example, you can have application like a chat, and you have one endpoint just listening to that particular chat, but there are multiple chat rooms are there. For each chat room, you have your own endpoint instance. So if you want to program your application such a way that the URLs are kind of dynamic, this kind of helps in that area. As I suggested, like WebSocket also has support for the sub protocols. You can negotiate between two peers what kind of a protocol at the application level you want to use. So in this case, let's say your endpoint knows how there is a custom chat protocol which is laid on top of WebSocket protocol, and that could be told to runtime so that during the negotiation, handshake request negotiation, I want to tell to the client that, okay, I know how to handle chat protocol. So for that, there is a sub-protocol annotation element on the WebSocket endpoint. There you could specify a bunch of sub-protocols so that during the handshake negotiation, that would be used to find out the exact sub-protocol. Okay. So I told briefly about the decoders, but we haven't seen how a decoder itself will be written. As I said, decoder primarily decodes the input source, the data basically, and converts into a certain object. So there are a bunch of decoders are possible. For text messages, you can the data, the runtime could give a data like string or a reader. So from there, the runtime, the decoder can read the data from the string and reader, and convert into whatever object you want in your application. So in this case, it is implementing decoder.textstream. That means there will be a decode method with it takes a reader and it converts to JSON object. So that's what it is doing. So the data is coming. The runtime, what it's doing is whatever the WebSocket request it's coming, the data is converted into reader and gives to your decoder. The decoder reads the data and converts to whatever the object which you want to deal with in this particular decoder. So that's all it is doing. So, but in WebSocket itself, there is no metadata. Like there is no content type for each request and response. So whereas in JAX-RS, they can take advantage of metadata and they can do certain things like, okay, if the content type is XML, I can convert into source. If the content type is something else, I can convert. But in the WebSocket protocol itself, there is no such metadata as such. So either you have to peek into the message and see like whether can I really create an object from this. For that purpose, there is a will decode method is there. So it will basically will actually probably I think even will decode will take a reader, I guess. So the decode in your decoder, you have to basically see the content or peek in the content. Can I create actually a JSON object from this one? So for that, there is a will decode method is there. I don't know how useful it would be, but so similarly for the binary data, you can get a byte buffer or you can get an input stream and convert that into corresponding object. On the other hand, we have encoders which can take an object and convert into bytes or write it into the output stream. So it's just analogous to what we have in the decoders. Okay. So in this case, it's taking a JSON object and writing into a writer. Or it can take a JSON object and return a string. If that is your if it is implementing encoder.txt, for example, then it would be returning a string. So there are a bunch of methods, different encoders, and you can create your own encoders and decoders and plug it into the runtime. So that basically covers a little bit of annotation-driven programming model. So other programming model which we have is interface-driven programming model. So it's particularly useful for, let's say, in the standalone programs in a C environment or something. You can just bootstrap yourself and create the whole WebSocket endpoint by yourself. So, for example, to create an endpoint here, you need to extend an abstract class called an endpoint. So it has a bunch of methods like onOpen, onClose, similar to what we have methods which are decorated with the annotations. But similar to that, we have a proper interface which you implement it. So in this case, the hello endpoint is extending endpoint and creating the actual endpoint. And it has a bunch of methods. And the open will be called when the connection is established. So it's getting a session object. So in the session object, as you know, it basically represents a connection or a conversation. So for the session object, it's adding a message handler. So whenever there is a message, what it's doing is it is trying to get the other side of the conversation or other side of the peer and sending the message. That's all it's doing. And you can add as many message handlers as possible as for the last couple of weeks back. But now I think this expert group is thinking to add only one particular message handler. So, okay, let's take a look at some of the other cases. How do you bootstrap this particular endpoint? So you created your own endpoint, but you want to start that particular endpoint in certain environment. So what is the URL you want to host it, or what is the context in which you want to host it? So for that, the spec has a way to create a servlet container, and you also create a certain kind of configuration. So the configuration could say that, okay, my endpoint requires to be hosted at this particular path, and it requests to have these sub-protocols, etc. So you create that particular endpoint configuration, and using the container, you publish the server, and you pass your endpoint, and you pass your configuration. So in the non-Pojo case, we also have client-side API. Actually, the client-side endpoints also coming using annotations also, but that's just been introduced a couple of days back. So let's say you have a client. That's also even the here even in the client also it's basically an endpoint as far as WebSocket is concerned, right? Because they are symmetrical. Once the connection is established, there is no concept of real client and server. But only for establishing the handshake, they basically you require a client which starts the handshake. So here client is also kind of endpoint. So it has methods, and in this onOpen method, all it is doing is let me get session.getRemote. That means session is a conversation. I want to get the remote endpoint of this session and start sending the data. So that means it's basically sending data to the server, this particular Hello World. So how do you bootstrap this client? So client also requires some kind of environment, what kind of protocols it supports, and which server it is trying to contact. Similar to the server container, we have a client container. So you have a client container, and then you create some kind of configuration for this particular client endpoint, where exactly it has to connect, things like that. Then you say client container dot connect to server. You pass your client endpoint and the configuration. So what kind of configuration you could use while configuring both server endpoints and client endpoints? You can have some kind of a URI or URI matching if you are using some kind of templating. What all sub protocols both client and server support? So that could be specified in the configuration. And what kind of message encoders and decoders are supported for both the sites? And different kinds of configuration is possible so that you can take full advantage of the WebSocket protocol. Okay, the main API class in the programmatic API is endpoint, which is representing a WebSocket endpoint, and a message handler that represents how to handle messages that are coming to the endpoint. The remote endpoint tells what is the other side of the peer. Like if you are a client, the other side of the peer would be the server. So that's what the remote endpoint gives to you. And session represents a connection, a conversation which connects both the peers. So as I said, this diagram has kind of changed a little bit because here it is using one WebSocket endpoint instance. So, but anyway, let me explain this diagram. So whenever a client is connecting, so it's creating, it's all the messages are going to one particular endpoint instance. So it is creating a per connection, it is creating a conversation or a connection, for example, you can think of. And for each session, you could associate multiple message handlers. Similarly, let's say if there is a new connection happens, so there is a new session or a new conversation is being established, and with this conversation, there are a bunch of message handlers, and all the messages are going to the same WebSocket endpoint instance. So, but as I said that the WebSocket endpoint instance itself, the scope itself is getting changed. So you will have multiple WebSocket endpoint instances based on for each connection there will be a separate endpoint instance in future, or it could use a CDA. So that is still in the works. So there are a bunch of methods actually while sending and receiving in the programmatic API. For example, like you could send a string message. Because we see that the messages could be text messages or messages could be binary messages. If you want a simple string message, you can send it. Or if you want to send, let's say, just a byte buffer as a binary message, you can send it. Or if the message is very huge, underneath we have frames. Like each message is basically decomposed of multiple frames. If you want to take advantage and if you have a huge message, rather than giving everything to the container, you can give multiple times. So you can send a partial string at a time, and you can keep on sending the entire message into small chunks. You can do that. Or you could have a writer, and people like to work with the blocking streams. So they can also use this blocking sends. So you can get a writer, and you can keep writing into that writer. And we also have variations using like, for example, async kind of features. Like you can get a future object. Like you can call this particular send method, it will return immediately, but it might not have sent. So you'll basically get a future object. In the future object, you'll get the status whether it has sent it or not. So that kind of flexibility is also available. Similarly, while receiving the message, there are quite a few methods are there. So some of this is getting simplified. So some people felt that there are too many message handlers. So are there are multiple decoders and multiple message handlers. So here also you have all kinds of various ways to register. I want to receive only the string type of messages, or I want to receive binary messages in byte buffer, or I want to receive only partial message. So there are a bunch of ways to receive messages, analogous to what we have in the sending of messages. Or you can send, actually I said, as a custom object. You can send a custom object. At that time it will find the corresponding decoder and converts that custom object. So you have a bunch of ways to receive and send the messages. Briefly talk about Java EE side of integration. So the way you deploy is you var your WebSocket endpoint classes, the classes that are decorated with WebSocket endpoint annotation, or the classes that extends away web endpoint classes. Then the web Java EE deployment takes or scans these classes and creates a corresponding basically plumbing, or it creates the WebSocket endpoints behind the scenes. So in the default case, web.xml is optional. Like even for the servlet case, now web.xml is optional. But if you want to configure any other security, for example, you can use same web.xml. So as you know, that handshake request is still a HTTP handshake request, right? So you can configure security for the HTTP portion using the whatever the security constraints that you typically configure for the web applications. The same constraints are enforced for the similar to WS endpoints, because the initial handshake is still HTTP. And Servlet 3.1 also introduced this standard mechanism for upgrade. So they're providing like HTTP servlet request dot do upgrade, and you can pass a protocol handler, and the implementation can take advantage of it. So that way, if you create a WebSocket implementation, that could be portable across servlet containers. If you use it, because all the servlet containers are going to support this particular mechanism. And if you create your own WebSocket implementation, the same WebSocket implementation will work on Jetty, it will work on Tomcat. So implementation can take advantage of this standard upgrade mechanism. So bunch of things still, as I said, a lot of things are in flux, so still we need to do quite a few things, like the package renaming kind of happened. So now the package is javax.websocket. And like deployment in different environments, how does the deployment will work in Java EE? How does the deployment will work in, for example, in SE kind of environment? Whether there is a difference between the client endpoints and servlet endpoints, or if you mix both client endpoints and servlet endpoints, does the deployment know that they are both are separate? Like, so that kind of deployment model is, I think, just got proposed, I think. And what is the scope of the endpoint instance? Can this endpoint be a AJB, or can this endpoint will have a different life cycle? So that's also being discussed. And some people felt that there is now at present you can attach multiple message handlers for each kind of type. So they kind of felt that that particular algorithm, when the request comes, how to find a corresponding message handler that handles the type for that particular message, that's kind of difficult. So they're trying to simplify that message handler and decoders. And other integration point is like a HTTP session. Like in the web application, you have a HTTP session. So can we share that HTTP session some way in the WebSocket endpoints? Obviously, because both of them are running in the same web container. The thing is, the WebSocket endpoint is a long-running connection. So in some cases, like a HTTP session might expire, still you might be receiving messages on the WebSocket connection. Right? So in that case, what should happen? If the HTTP session is getting terminated and you still have a WebSocket connection, should we terminate the WebSocket connection also, or should we leave some option to the client, should we leave some option to the application to know that, okay, the session is getting terminated, do you want to terminate your WebSocket connection also? because there is no way to touch your HTTP session because there are no HTTP requests. So the client will obviously don't know that there is, unless there is a new HTTP request, you cannot really send the cookies back to the client. So there are few tricky things to solve here, how to use of HTTP session. And we require general overall integration with the rest of Java EE platform, like CDA, how does it work with CDA, et cetera, et cetera. So we have a bunch of things the expert group is working on. So okay, I'll just briefly go over our demo so that you'll get some pictures. So okay, so I have a small group draw server. So you have a bunch of clients coming together and drawing certain drawing on certain canvas primarily. So I have a group draw server. It has decorated with WebSocket endpoint, and it is hosted at /draw. And it is also specifying a drawing message decoder and drawing message encoder. So at present, as I said, that all of them coming to the same instance. So when on open is happening, so it got one particular client that is being added to this particular peers list. When the client is going away, so it is sending, basically it is removing that from this particular peers list. And when the message is coming, so it is decorated with WebSocket message, it is, the runtime is trying to create a JSON object. Okay, so when the message is received, what it's doing is, all it is doing is, I am receiving a message from one particular client, except that client I want to send it to or reflect to all other clients. That way, let's say, it's just like a, something like a chat message. If you receive a chat message, you want to send that particular chat message to all other clients, except to yourself. So that's all it is doing. It's getting the remote endpoint of all the peers and start sending that particular object, whatever the object it received. So how does the WebSocket runtime know how to convert bytes to JSON object? So we have basically both decoder and encoder. So here in case of decoder, it is implementing decoder.txt. That means it's taking a string object and trying to convert into JSON object. So in this case, it's just using a JSON aux implementation, JSON object, and passing the string, it will converting into JSON object. Similarly, the encoder is also pretty straightforward. It is taking a JSON object and it is trying to convert into string. So the string will be actually written to the bytes using a WebSocket endpoint. So it's pretty straightforward example. So as you could see that we have just one WebSocket endpoint, bunch of one encoder and one decoder. And whenever there is a connection, it is getting added. Whenever there is a disconnect, it is removing the connections. And whenever there is a message is happening, so it's just sending the message to other clients. So I have three clients actually. So one is two Chrome browsers and other is a Safari browser. So the whole, it's hosted at sample draw. So here also I am hosting it. One second. Let me, in this case, I'll show you briefly about the developer tools so that you can see the traffic, what's going on. So here, localhost sample draw. So here, localhost. Okay, so let me change some of them to blue, some of them to red. So it's just drawing few objects like square, circle, etc. So here, let me try to say green with something like small square or something. So let's say if I put some object in this one particular window, it is basically a message is being sent to the server, and the server is sending two messages to the separate clients, because there are basically three connections are happening to the server, and if one message comes, it basically reflecting that message to two clients. So let's say if I put something here, so the same message is basically sent to the other two. So if you see the traffic, I don't know whether you can see it. So initially we have a HTTP request happened, so which is that's sample. So this is where we had the actual HTTP request and handshake has happened. So as you could see that the request header sent upgrade mechanism, and it sent a key, and it sent a WebSocket version, and the response headers it got upgraded. And you could see what I think it's switching the protocols to 101. So in this case, I think Chrome developer tools also has a support for frames. What's the exact message it's getting received? So here we are transferring JSON. That's how our encoders and decoders are there. So it has received basically green and blue kind of messages for square and big circle. So you could also send messages from here if you want, or you can send anything. So that is getting reflected in other side. So if you see, as you could see that we sent bunch of messages here. So similarly, you can see the traffic. Yeah, that's all I wanted to show in the developer tools. Basically, you can see the complete data, like what is being received and what is being sent. Whether I don't know whether it shows if you have multiple. Yeah, I think probably it will show if the message contains expands across multiple frames. I think that's all I have. So let me open up the resources so that you can take a look at them. Yeah, so I have 4 minutes or so left for question and answers. So participate in this particular WebSocket.spec. You can follow all the discussion on the expert group. And if you have any feature requests or anything you want to see in the spec, send it a mail across on the user's mailing list. Yeah, so if you have any questions, please ask me. Yes, please. So the question is like if both the client is sending and receiving, it doesn't know what is the request and what is the response. It's just like you think about if you have done socket programming, so you have both client side input stream and basically you have two connections. It's exactly like that. It's up to your application to deal with it, like what is the end of the message and what is the start of. So at WebSocket level, all you get is basically, okay, this is a message, this is a message. That's all we will get. So you have to relate between the client and send or whatever logic you want to incorporate in your application.
I have another question regarding the proxy and firewall support.
Yeah. So the question is about the support of proxies and firewalls. So you... it's kind of like if you typically, what I heard is like if you use direct proxies, it's most probably you won't see any problem. Like especially the client is directly setting that, okay, this is a proxy. So then they use HTTP connect and they just tunnel the request. But if you are using like, let's say transparent proxies, then there could be issues. The proxy probably doesn't know this is a WebSocket. And it thinks that it's okay. It looks like a HTTP, but after some time it sees that, oh, this is not really HTTP, so it might terminate. So the transparent proxies probably need to add support for the WebSocket. So right now they don't have. So I think there is, if you Google it, I think you will see some information. I think some products try to solve certain way, but in general, I think it requires some more support from the transparent proxies and some other intermediaries, yeah. I think you have a question, right?
My question basically about fallbacks. Is there anything that can configure fallbacks if the browser does not support
So the question is about fallbacks. Like, let's say if the client doesn't support it, is there any way to? So it's just a JavaScript API. So in the JavaScript API, if you find out like if it doesn't support WebSocket or something, you try to do whatever way. But there are, I think, there are some implementations which will try to wrap it. And if the, let's say, if the client doesn't support it, underneath they will try to use long polling, etc. But yeah, as it depends like how you write your client-side JavaScript library. Other than that, there is nothing in the protocol itself. There is nothing. Okay, time's up. If you have any questions, yeah, I will be here for some time. Thank you.